Going through a four-week series talking about what God wants for your life. And last week we looked at this fact that God wants you to be a member of His family. That's the plan that He has for you, that you would be a member of His family. God wants that so bad that He created us, number one, for fellowship, and then sin came and deformed what God had created. Sin brought destruction, sin brought death, but God still wanted us to be part of His family, so He had a plan called redemption. And then He simply says, whoever puts their faith in Me, they will be My child. God wants you to be part of His family. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. By the way, these four things I'm talking about, this is the second one today, then two more weeks, they all are causes for worship. Some people, and we have this in part of the thing that we do here, we talk about things that we do as a church or things that God wants us to do. It's my opinion that the primary purpose for every Christian and for every church is this, that we be designed as expressions of worship to God. That's the purpose of my life, is to worship God. Now, how do I worship? Why do I worship? Those are the keys. Worship is a lot more than simply singing some songs. That helps us get into a spirit of worship. But worship is about loving God with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, all your strength. That's what worship is. So therefore, that's the greatest command, Jesus said. So loving God is the purpose of my life and of your life. What is the calling that we all have together? It's to love God fully and completely. To love God fully and completely, we have to become part of His family. We have to have that relationship to fully love God. So today I'm going on to a second topic that says that God wants you, and He wants me, to be a model of His character. He wants us to be made into the image of Jesus Christ. So there's a whole lot of scripture today I'm going to try to give you. And if you want to write references down, you can. If not, you can go back and watch it later. And we'll have some of these notes up later in the week. 1 Timothy chapter 6 is where I want us to look at initially. And then we're going to use a lot of different scripture. This is kind of a broad approach at a topic, not zooming in on the microscopic today, but very much a macro type thought for us today. Here's what Paul says to Timothy: true godliness with contentment is itself great wealth. Now, earlier in this chapter, I feel like I have to give you this to give you a little bit of the background. Earlier in this chapter, Paul is talking about the relationship that people should have with those that they connect with, and he's speaking specifically of an era that was not good, that is not endorsed by the Bible, but it was a reality. It was a reality for our country for many years, and thank God that it has been abolished for a long time. But what he speaks about at the first part of this chapter is people who are slaves. And here's what he says. He does not speak in favor or against. That's not his purpose in this writing. If he were to speak, he would speak against it. But that's not what he's talking about. Here's what he's talking about. He says, if you are a slave, then live your life in such a way that it brings glory and honor to God. Now that principle should be easy for all of us to embrace. I think it would be very difficult for a slave to embrace that. It would be easy as a slave and understandable to think this isn't fair, this isn't right, I'm not a piece of property, I am a person, this should not happen. But Paul says, even though that's wrong and that's not right, not in this place, but he says in other places, even though that's not right, you still do what's right. Now here's the principle. This is probably controversial to some people, although it shouldn't be, because they're going to highlight the one thing and, you know, this goes viral because of like, a WASO pastor speaks about slavery, they're misunderstanding the point altogether. Here is the main point. Whatever situation I am in life, I need to conduct my life in such a way that it brings glory and honor to God and never would be a cause for disgrace for the kingdom of God. Unfortunately, many believers are the first to complain, the first to criticize, the first to gripe, the first to whine about how bad everybody's treating them. And when we focus on our problem, and that becomes the source of all of our thoughts, and we begin to be absorbed in self-pity, it's not going to get better. You got to work yourself out of your problem. I haven't said this in a long time, so I'm probably due to say this again. As a child of God, how many of you are children of God? Just say amen in the room, so I know I'm talking to some of the right people. As children of God, and you're working somewhere, and you're getting paid a certain wage, now, unless they lied to you, told you one thing and did something different, and even then, you are where you are, so live in a way that honors and glorifies God. It has amazed me the number of people that have worked for a company for a number of years, and they complain about the salary they are receiving. And my thought is simply this. Somewhere at one point in time, you told them, I will take your job for the amount of money that you want to pay me. So if you don't like that arrangement, you have a couple of options that I think are honorable. Quit and go find another job. That's honorable. Work hard to the point that you become so valuable to the organization that they want to give you more money because they could not afford the thought of losing you. The one option that I do not think honors and glorifies God is for you to gripe and complain about how poorly you're being treated. You're shouting me down now. This is what pastors do. They hit you with some hard truth occasionally. And it relates to all the topic of what I'm going to speak of today, which is that we have to become more like Jesus Christ. You know the one thing that you will never find in Scripture, the one sentiment you never see in the life of Christ ever, and was he mistreated more than any other person to ever be on the planet. But you never see him, not one time does he whine, not one time does he complain, not one time does he gripe. The only thing he says is in private to God, and he goes, why have you forsaken me? Most of us, you know, as believers in Christ, we think we have to guard our language, which is a good idea, by the way. We think there are certain words that are out of bounds, great idea, by the way. But because we don't use those words, we kind of make up our own. They carry the same sentiment. I call it Christian cussing. We think we're better because we didn't actually use that word over there, but in our heart, it was the same thing going on. You know that Jesus, here's what the Bible says, when he was taken through all these horrible steps, false accusations, unfair judgments, all the things that happened in his life, the Bible says he did not open his mouth. Let me get back to where I need to be here. Godliness with contentment is great wealth. After all, we brought nothing with us when we came into the world, and we can't take anything with us when we leave. My favorite phrase for that is there's no U-Haul behind the hearse. So if you have enough food and clothing, be content. That's good stuff right there. It's the same thing I said about money a while ago. Contentment is not about how much you have. Some of the most discontented people in the world are people who have a lot of money. The amount of money you have does not guarantee you contentment. Contentment is an inside job. It is a commitment to be happy with what you have and to focus on what you have instead of focusing on what you don't have. Jealousy, envy, those things come because I'm not looking at what I have. I'm looking at what someone else has. I'm not looking at what blessings are in my life. I'm looking at what other blessings are out there that I don't have. And so I get all worried and keyed up about what I don't have instead of thanking God for what I do have. Can I give you a great word of encouragement and instruction to make your life better immediately today? Start looking at your blessings. Start counting them. Start thanking God for them. And before you get through, you'll realize, I don't even have any time to complain or grumble or gripe right now. And as a byproduct, I'm happy. Be content in life. Let me go on here. People who long to be rich. Kind of sound like America to you? People who long to be rich fall into temptation. And they are trapped by many foolish and harmful desires that plunge them into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. And some people, craving money, have wandered from the true faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. Now look, I understand life. I wish everything in life was free. But it's not. One of my friends says it so eloquently. He says, I don't need the money. It's those people that I owe that want the money. I understand it takes money to live. The Bible never condemns money. It just encourages us to have the right, first of all, perspective about it, number one. And then number two, to make sure that we use it in the proper fashion for the right reasons. Paul says to Timothy, when people crave money, they do much damage to their soul. But you, Timothy, are a man of God, so run from all these evil things. Pursue righteousness and a godly life along with faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight for the true faith. Hold tightly to the eternal life to which God has called you, which you have confessed so well before many witnesses. God wants us to be molded to the image of Jesus. And he's provided the resources that we need to make that happen. Let me share a few thoughts with you this morning, and we're going to conclude today with communion and looking at what the Lord has done for us and how we should be grateful and how we should make it our goal to become like him. God has called us to be like Jesus. Romans chapter 8, 29 and 30 is a couple of verses of which there's much religious debate. And I'm not even going to go toward any of the debatable parts today. I'm going to talk about what is clearly stated here and what is known. We can talk about the rest later if you want to. But here's what it says in the New Living Translations. Romans 8, 29 says, for God knew his people in advance, and he chose them to become like his son, so that his son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And having chosen them, he called them to come to him. And having called them, he gave them right standing with himself. And having given them right standing, he gave them his glory. God has called us and chosen us to be like his son. Now here's the problem. Isaiah talks about this in chapter 5 when it talks about the people who have lost perspective and priorities and who've lost values in life. And the problem is this, that somehow the devil, one of his great deceptions is to deceive Christians and non-Christians alike in thinking that God's commandments are hard and difficult and they're mean and they're not enjoyable and they're going to make life a drudgery. I remember I've told you this story before, but when I was, I think, in 10th or 11th grade, In science class, we were at tables, two students together, kind of a laboratory type class and whatever. And the guy that was beside me was, I want to use my words carefully here now. He was involved in providing illegal resources for people in the school who enjoyed partying on the weekend. I'll just kind of leave it at that. And he sat by me. So you got the preacher's kid and the dealer. And we kind of got along okay. I think he was intrigued by me, and I got to be honest, I was intrigued by him a little bit, trying to figure this whole thing out. And I remember one time he couldn't get his head wrapped around it. And he's like, so what do you do for fun, McCarty? What's your weekend like? You haven't put like an extra little bit of vanilla in your shake to really just get everything going? And the concept that many non-believers have, but even believers have, is I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, but oh, it means I have to give up a whole lot of things, and I don't really get to enjoy life, and it's just this drudgery, but one day it's all going to end, and I get to go to heaven. I guess it'll be good then. Listen, the Bible says this repeatedly. Paul writes this. Peter writes this. God has given you everything you need for life. Jesus said, I've come to give you life, and not just a little bit, but life that is overflowing, life that is abundant, life that is to the max. The reality is that what the devil is selling as exciting is destructive. It's not beneficial. It's not something that will make your life better. The first thing you have to see this is God commands you to lead a godly life, and that command is not hard, is not difficult. Here's what it says in 1 John chapter 5, verses 3 and 4. This is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. And His commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. The commands of God are given for our benefit, not for our detriment. They are there to preserve life, not to prevent life. They are there that we would enjoy life to the fullest, not that somehow we would walk in drudgery. The commandments of God are good. Let me help you out even more than that. They are not arbitrary, but they are corollary. Let me define those words for you. They're not random, but they have a connection. Let me exemplify. Now, this is not a bad thing necessarily, but let's say all my kids are grown out of school, out of college, so I go to grandkids now. But let's say my granddaughter, I say to her, Harper, here's what I'm going to do for you. Poppy's going to do this. If you get all A's all year long, I'm going to give you a $100 bill when school's out. That is an arbitrary reward. There's no connection between the two. I could have just as easily said $50. Or if I wanted to get back at my daughter and her husband, I could say a new pony. There's no connection between what I'm offering her and what she's doing. Now, here's a better connection. This wouldn't be quite as enjoyable. But I could say to her, Harper, if you study real hard and get all A's, and you keep doing that every year until you graduate high school, then you're going to get a scholarship to college. That's corollary. Let me help you out on the negative side. Your doctor says to you, you need to lose 20 pounds because you're on the verge of becoming diabetic. You can't say to your doctor, let's come up with another equation. How about I grow 3 inches more hair? And that's, no. That's arbitrary. This is corollary. God's commandments are not arbitrary. They're not just randomly made up. They correlate to something. There's a reason why God said, one man, one woman, come together in marriage. I'm going to give you a gift of intimacy as part of that marriage celebration, and it's to be for life. There's a purpose to that. There's a reason. Some of you may, this may help some of you right now. God doesn't say, bring me a portion of your income, because He's up in heaven fearing that somehow there's going to be an economic crisis in heaven. When you give, it releases something from your life, from your heart, that brings blessing to you. Every command of God is designed for your good, to prevent or to preserve your enjoyment of life, not to prevent your fun. Becoming a godly, holy, sanctified person is a life of joy, is a life of goodness. I know we all know that person out there who is legalistic, and they may not even know God, but they're religious. And we look at them and we think, I don't want that, neither do I. But there's another option. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. Follow him every day. Trust him. Know that he's leading you in a path that leads to life and blessing. Draw near to God. Second thing about this whole thing with becoming a model of his character is that Jesus is your example. John 13, verses 15 through 17. This is the chapter where Jesus has just washed the feet of the disciples. Unfortunately, culturally, that makes no relevance to us at all. Out of curiosity, how many of you in the room have ever been to, this is kind of a weird question right here, a foot washing service? Let me see your hand. Some of you have, okay. This is just me right now. It's very spiritual and very good in a lot of ways, but it's a little bit weird. It's kind of awkward. When Jesus washed the feet of the disciples, again, it wasn't some arbitrary activity. It wasn't like, hey, take your shoes off. Do you understand the time of Christ, the major mode of transportation was what I'm doing right now, walking. Most of the people in that time didn't have shoes like we have hardly at all, but most of them had sandals on or something, and there was no pavement, no concrete, no asphalt. You can say praise God or oh me or whatever, but that wasn't. So as you walked, your feet would get dirty on every journey that you took. It was a custom in every home, in every place, there was a basin of water and towel at the front there. And one of the servants, when you came in, would wash your feet. It's even more, we don't have anything that I've thought of. If you think of one, tell me after church, because I'd love to hear it. The closest I can come to is polishing somebody's shoes, but that's really not quite the same. This was something that was done that was very personal, very intimate, very necessary. So it's not, again, it's not just some action that for us today has very little meaning, but back then was essential. So what Jesus is showing us is not just random activity, but it's very intentional help that is given that is also a statement of humility, taking the role of the servant. You remember, this is identified by what Peter says. You remember what Peter says when Jesus says, take your shoes off, I'm going to wash your feet. And Peter goes, not me, Lord. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part of me. That Peter is that everybody needs someone like Simon Peter in your life that just kind of emotionally goes all over the place, you know. I'm going to wash your feet. No, you're not. Well, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part of me. Okay, not just my feet, but everywhere. Just wash my head, just shampoo my hair. Whatever you're feeling like, it's all good. I mean, he just swings all over the place. Jesus is an example to us of what it means to serve. He's an example of what it means to walk in humility. Look at what Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 7 or 8 down here. Having this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. In other words, he didn't hang on to that. But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of man, and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death. Let me go back and read that phrase. If you don't have your Bible open, I'm out of the ESV, the English Standard Version. But listen to this phrase again. Let me back up just a little bit here. He did not count equality with God as a thing to be held on to, but he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of the death, even the death on a cross. Do you know what the real sign of a disciple of Jesus Christ is? The real sign of someone who's being conformed to the image of Jesus is that they walk in obedience to God. Matthew chapter 28. Now, there's two parts to becoming a disciple. One is knowledge. You can't grow if you don't know. One is knowledge, but knowledge is not enough. Knowledge must then be activated through obedience. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew 28, what we call the Great Commission, He tells his disciples, go into all the world and to preach the gospel. And he tells them to baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he says this, teaching them to obey everything I commanded. Now, there are a lot of Christians that they think that to obey should be taken out, the way they live their life. And they think it's this, teaching them all I have commanded. I know the commandments. I know what I'm supposed to do. I know what's expected of me. But the key is not just knowing, but it's knowing and obeying. Can you just in your heart agree with me on this thought and say, oh God, teach us to know and obey your commands. Because they lead to life, not death. You're our example, Lord, and as we follow you, we will have abundant life. Think about other things where Jesus displayed character that we should emulate in our life. How about in compassion? Matthew chapter 9:36 tells us he looked upon the crowd and he was moved with compassion for them. May God restore our compassion for lost people. Not from a sense of we're up here and they're down here. Not a condescending view at all, but rather a compassion that says we are brothers and sisters and you have not experienced the fullness of what God has for you yet, and I'm praying that God would lead you in the path of righteousness. I want to be a light that shines into your life. How about the love that Jesus showed in his life? One of the traits that's most obvious and most significant in the life of Jesus is the love that he loved even when he was being crucified. How about forgiveness? Again, going back to the cross, his prayer on the cross was this, Father, forgive them. Transparency moment right here. My prayer would have probably been this in my natural inclination. Father, take note of who's here. There's going to be a payday someday. But for the very ones who condemned him to death, he cried for forgiveness. How about his devotion and commitment? You look at the life of Christ, and there's so many things I could say about this, but he continually was doing what needed to be done, the right place, the right time, the right attitude, getting things done because of his commitment. You know, when I love the one story, when there are several stories like this, where he's talking to the disciples, and it's obviously they don't have a clue what he's talking about. In John chapter 4, they show up, and they say, Lord, aren't you hungry? And he says, I have meat to eat that you know not of. And they're kind of looking at each other like, well, who brought him food? What do you mean? Where'd that come from? They did not understand what he was saying. He's saying, my purpose in life is not about temporary things. It's about eternal things. And his commitment to those things never wavered. The Bible talks about him setting his face toward Jerusalem with an absolute determination, unshakable, unmovable. Think about Jesus and his prayer life. What an example he is for us. He prayed in the morning. He prayed at night. He prayed for hours. He had moments of a specific prayer that were powerful. His life was marked by prayer. Now think about the irony of that. This is God in the flesh. And he prayed. And some believers feel like, you know, me and God are so tight, I really don't need to pray that much. One of the greatest things that you can do with your life to experience the fullness of what God has for you is spend time with him in prayer. And by the way, let me help you out. Prayer is not me coming with my list and going over it for 15 minutes and telling him his marching orders for the day. Prayer is me coming and say, God, speak into my life. God, give me direction. God, help me. God, I don't know what I'm going to do if you don't give me wisdom today. I don't know how I'm going to make it. God, please speak to me in this moment right now, but throughout the day, give me sensitivity to feel your spirit speaking to me every day. Once you get into this realm of life, Many of you can attest to this and identify with this, and it's something we have to cultivate every day. But once you get to that place where your spiritual hearing has been heightened to the point that you hear the Spirit frequently, it's a pretty awesome thing. And that's when you begin to realize you're on assignment from God. And He tells you something to do, and you just do it because you heard the Spirit speak. It's not always something that's incredibly traceable. It's not that you can say this happened, and therefore here's the outcome. Sometimes we don't know the seed that we're sowing, but God, help us to be men and women of prayer who seek your face, who listen to your voice, who study your word. How about patience and endurance? I love this verse right here. This is a great verse that Paul talks about how that Jesus Christ showed him mercy. It's 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 16. Listen to this. But I received mercy for this reason, so that in me, the worst of them, Christ Jesus might demonstrate his extraordinary patience as an example to those who would believe in him for eternal life. Isn't that a great verse? Paul said, by the way, one of the marks, it's one that's coming up right here in a second, of Jesus' life was his humility. Now, I know that compared to him, you're probably enormously gifted and talented. Compared to him, you probably have a lot of life purpose. But he walked in humility. How many of you think maybe we should too? One of the things I see in this verse that's amazing is Paul's writing to Timothy, and here's what he says, one of his latter letters that he writes, and he says, I received mercy for this reason, so that in me, the worst of them, Christ Jesus might demonstrate his extraordinary patience as an example to those who would believe in him for eternal life. I don't ever want to be a soapbox preacher, and I'm not just trying to pick on things I don't like and get up and give you my list of things that I find offensive in the world. But I'm going to kind of do that right now for a second. Because it's amazing to me that in the Christian world, there are people who feel like they have to have titles. And as they get older, they have to have more titles and bigger titles. And Paul, in one of his last letters, says, I'm the worst of anybody. I'm just telling you, I don't see that on a business card. John the Baptist understood it very well. He said, I must decrease, and he must increase. I think there's a principle there. When I'm trying to increase, and I'm trying to say, everybody, look at me. Do you know who I am? Do you know what I've done? Do you know my titles? Do you know all of the things I'm bringing to the table? When I'm doing that, you know what I'm really doing to Jesus? I'm making him small, and I'm making me big. Would you again just join me today in this prayer right now? God, help us to get out of your way. Help us to be small enough that you can be big. Paul said it this way. We used to sing it as kids. When we are weak, then he is strong. Now that's not a statement of I'm going to flounder around and not try to do my best, but my best is weak. I don't have the ability or power to accomplish a lot of good in my own strength. And when I realize that my best is still weak, that's when his greatness can show through. Jesus Christ is our example. Obedience is your proper response to his example. Obedience will bless your life. When you obey God, I've already talked about it. When you obey God, it blesses your life. Not only that, but when you obey God, it blesses other people. See, that's God's plan. He has put you in the body of Christ in the place where you fit so that together the body of Christ is complete, and your obedience to that brings blessing to other people. When you obey God, it blesses the kingdom of God. It blesses the big church, the big C church. It makes everything better when you obey God and do what he says. And understanding that, God wants you to be an example to other Christians. He wants you to be a model of his character. Some people want to back off this real quick and say, I'm not that good. Then you're on the right track to begin with. So you got to depend on him every day. You got to have his help every day. You've got to renew yourself every day. You've got to have a spirit about you that says, I am on a journey to live in a way that people can follow my example, and as I walk, they follow after me. Paul said it in the church at Corinth in chapter 11, verse 1 of the first book. He said, be imitators of me as I imitate Christ. 1 Thessalonians, he says this in chapter 1, verse 7. He says, you, speaking of the Thessalonians, you became an example to all the believers in Macedonia. And then 1 Timothy chapter 4, he speaks to Timothy and he says to Timothy these astonishing words. He says, let the believers see you as an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. One of the keys of the church accomplishing God's purpose is for every member of the church, and I'm not talking about card-carrying member that you filled out the forms, but every person who attends the church, everyone who comes, is to take their responsibility to be a model of God's grace. It will change the place you work. It will change the neighborhood and where you live. It'll change the family that you share a home with. It will change everything when you say, God, let me be a model of your character. Let me live like Jesus. Now, for that to happen, we have to utilize the resources that God's given us. How can we truly be a model of the character of God, the character of Jesus Christ? How can we model that kind of character? Number one, real simple, we have to be born again. It's a spiritual thing. You have to become a child of God. That's the first key. Secondly, you have to be filled with the Spirit of God. Those are good things. Can somebody say amen? Those should be the continual focus for every believer. Celebrating your salvation, number one. How many of you want to celebrate every day the fact that you're a child of God? That should never get old. Lord, help us to celebrate that every day. And secondly, we need to every day say, Lord, now fill me with the Holy Spirit so that I have wisdom beyond my ability, so that I have strength beyond my ability, so that I have discernment beyond my ability. How many of you would like to do things bigger, better, stronger, more than what you're doing right now? You need the Holy Spirit. You can only go so far. And by the way, that's not very far. With the Holy Spirit's power, you are more than capable to be the person God wants you to be. I want you to bow your heads with me for a moment. And in just a moment, we're going to take communion. So if you'll hang with us, we'll give you time to be done before noon for sure. If you're here today, I want to ask a couple of questions. Number one, if you've not put your faith in Jesus Christ and you're not part of his family, right now is the time to say, I want to receive God's grace in my life. I want to know that my sins are forgiven. I want to commit myself to being a follower of Jesus. If that's you today, I want to pray for you. Would you raise your hand right now all across the room? How many would there be? Say, that's what I need in my life today. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, help us in our commitment to follow you. Amen. Help us in our commitment to follow you. I'm going to ask you to ask God to give you clear vision right now of what I'm talking about. And I want you to evaluate your own life. I'm not asking you to be hard. I'm not asking you to be soft. I'm asking you to be accurate. How many of you would have to be honest today and say, you know, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven, but I don't really model the character of Jesus nearly as much as I should. But I would like to create a commitment today and ask for God's help that I would be a model of His character. I want that in my life. Would you raise your hand all over the room? I need that in my life a lot more. Can I tell you, the daily renewal is the key. Daily renewal is the key. How many of you would say, I'm trying to the best of my ability to be a model of Jesus, but I just want to recommit my life to keep on that path and keep going that direction? Would you raise your hand all across the room? That's my goal in life. That's my purpose. That's what I want to do. I've often thought on days like today, sermons like today, somewhere I'm challenging you to change your life and live for God in a way that you become a model of His character. I've often thought, I kind of wish that I could go with you through the week and just kind of be there on your shoulder, kind of giving you help and direction. No, don't do that. Yes, do that. What? Go here. No, don't go there. But obviously I can't. But I have something better to offer you today than me anyway, because I'm not that good. If you desire it, God today wants you to be so aware of His presence through the ministry of the Holy Spirit that you have guidance every moment of every day. But we have to make a conscious decision to depend upon Him. It's what Proverbs tells us way, way back over in chapter 3. Don't lean on your own understanding. Don't pick your own path. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will make your path straight. He will put you in the right place. So right now, no matter which one of those first three you raised your hand on, or if you didn't even raise your hand, I'm going to ask one more question. How many of you today would say, I want the Holy Spirit to fill my life to such capacity that He's guiding me every moment of every day, and He is leading me where I need to be? Pastor, I don't want you sitting on my shoulder through the week, but I would like the Holy Spirit not to be on my shoulder, but in my heart, guiding me and helping me. How many of you want that and you commit to that? Would you lift your hand right now all across the room? Would you join me in this prayer? We're going to have another prayer at the very end before we conclude, but right now, join me in this prayer of commitment. God, I pray that You would work in our hearts to make us aware of our dependency on You. Jesus, You told us in John 15 that You're the vine. We're the branches. And if we're not connected to You, we have no fruitfulness. I pray today that we would be so aware of the need to let You rise up within us, to allow us to be a model of Your character. May people say about us, as they identified Your early followers, that You act like Jesus, that we see Jesus in You, that You are reflecting the character and the nature of Jesus. May that be said of each one of us. May it be more obvious than any other point of identity. Jesus, may You be lifted up. May You be exalted in the way that we live. May we humble ourselves before You, and may we become models of Your character, because You've empowered us with the Holy Spirit. You are guiding us with Your word. You are speaking to us in prayer. You are encouraging us through the fellowship of the saints. Lord, I pray today that we would honor You in all that we do. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. The communion service is a little bit different today. There are two cups together. It's supposed to be that way. The bottom one has the bread. The top one has the juice. We're trying some different things to get this the best way we can. And If you don't like it, you can talk to me about it. Give me your ideas. And if you got a great one, we would love to hear it. But we have them together this way. So take the two cups that are there together. You can pull them apart once you get them. Hold them until everyone has been served. And then we'll partake together. The Bible says that it's a good thing for all of us to participate in this if we are a follower of Christ. And in this moment, if there's any sin in our life, we confess it and we receive forgiveness. So right now, I encourage every believer, whether you go to our church or not, to join in the celebration of remembering the death, the resurrection of Jesus, the life that he now gives us. So if you would, take those elements, hold them till all have been served, and we'll partake together. Pastor Russell, lead us in a song of worship to the Lord.